Hello and good time of day to all of you, my chess friends, here on the Internet Chess Club. This is Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky bringing you the final report on the Moscow candidates. Today was the day the two leaders went head-to-head and, well, the luck was on the side of the Russian Grandmaster Sergei Karjakin, who beat Fabiana Caruana and by virtue of that won the tournament and will be facing Magnus Carlsen later this year in... of all places, New York City. Of course, I will concentrate today on that game, but first let me be a good journalist and just give you a quick report on other games. All right, Giri Topalov, obviously two people. Okay, that should probably not have any good memories about this tournament. Well, Topalov dead last, minus five. Giri... No, 13 draws, going for the record setting, 14th draw, and the record that maybe can be equaled one day, but it's just never going to be broken, right? Okay, this game did not disappoint. Or maybe it did disappoint. Alright, so when they played this Catalan and Giri went 95, probably looking to play one of these lines, we were white. Wins a pawn eventually, but black gets good compensation. Alright, maybe. But Topalov played the other move that is recently is getting more popular, c5. It's actually quite playable. Alright, this capture, and then the idea was to get this better endgame for white. Knight back to c3, but black plays sharply, so all they develop and the say, okay, which pawn do you want? You want the b7 pawn or you want the c4 pawn? Well, if white does this stuff, then of course he leaves black with a potentially weak pawn. But we're talking some major counterplay on the b-file, of course. And Giri, true to himself, plays this and now rook d8. Now, rook d8, I believe, is much better, much, much stronger move than the previously seen bishop d7. Bishop d7 is defensive, and that allows white to build up certain pressure after bishop f4. Whatever, you go rook d8, castles. Bishop there, rook, and rook to d1. It may not seem much, but the thing is that white can always go knight d6, and it will gain him the bishop pair. The bishop pair, even in symmetrical pawn structure, is quite an advantage. Now, ask Hikaru Nakamura how much fun he had defending this against Magnus Carlsen in one of the recent encounters. Yeah, but Topalov, well, truth to tell, Topalov, people say that Topalov was not prepared for the tournament, and but what does this mean, being prepared or not prepared? Is that the novelties? Everybody talks about novelties. They say, well, and this... Carlsen didn't play in that tournament because he saves up his novelties for the World Championship match. It doesn't work like this. There's no magic bullet. There's no recipe, you know. There's no novelty that help you to win games. Well, no, no. Novelties are just like this. Maybe little improvements. And Topalov was quite okay in that. I don't think he was lacking that. I think he was lacking in his game... was tactical sharpness. He had his chances beginning with game 1, where Anand gave him a chance to play knight takes f2, and that didn't happen. That was the beginning of the slide, which Veselin was not able to stop. Now, I think his bad form is already continuing since the Sinkfield Cup in August, and it remains to be seen what Veselin wants. Now, he's probably not going to be... getting a whole lot of invitations, because he dropped a lot of rating points. He's near 2750 territory. But he will play a tournament in Norway now. Now, this is interesting. Super tournament in Norway with Magnus and Karjakin and Aronin and Giri and whatever. So, Veselin is there. How he's going to handle this? It starts in 2 weeks. I suspect that regardless, you know, Veselin probably needs